Well, welcome back. Always good to have you here. With, you know, you're making it a yearly occasion, which is very nice.
Thank you very much indeed.
Keep them coming. Keep them coming.
Thank you.
Okay. This is so wonderful. This is beautiful. And I was just saying off camera that, you know, you don't know a lot of, sometimes when you study a writer, poet, whatever, in school, you don't really know a lot about their background. Sometimes, legitimately, because you don't really know a lot about them. But Emily Dickinson, she's so fascinating. And what was it about her that you thought, geez, I really want to bring her story to the big screen?
Well, I discovered her poetry when I was 18. There was a little program on television about her, and Claire Bloom was reading the poetry. So I ran out and bought a small collection, and they just give you a pressie in the front of what her life was. And it said something like, she, you know, didn't marry, and she stayed single till she died. And it wasn't until many years later that, about 10 years ago now, I started to reread some of the poems. I've got to find out more about her. And I read six biographies and found this extraordinary life, you know, who someone who apparently withdrew from the world and did nothing.
Yes.
But of course, the fight is intellectual and spiritual. That's what the fight is, you know. And being in that very close family, I was in a very close family. I'm the youngest of 10.
Wow.
So I know when people fall out with their favorite brother or sister, it's vicious. And as you've got to make these arguments really vicious. You go for one another. But the family is all that is both wonderful and terrible in life. But her spiritual journey, I think, is really heartbreaking, because I don't think at the end of that spiritual journey she is sure that the soul survives and that there is something beyond this.
Yeah, it's an amazing story. She really has a truly amazing story. And what can I say? Cynthia Nixon, seriously, there's nothing that woman can't do. I mean, honestly, you know, give her a phone book and I'd watch her on the stage. Like, honest to God, she's so good. But she was telling me, and I didn't know the story, that she said that you had, because I said it must have been very flattering for you that Terrence had written this with you in mind. And she told me that you were watching Sex in the City with the sound down. I go, where do you see Miranda and Emily Dickinson?
Well, it was when the reaction shots, and her reactions were always the most true.
Yeah.
That's how you can tell. Because I have to be honest about it, because I didn't like the program. And you can learn a great deal watching something with the sound off. You know, I tried to do that on television, on planes, because I can't watch anything. That's the game I play. Can I sort out what the story is? And very often you can't, you give up after about half an hour. But it tells you a lot when someone's just got to look and react. And her reactions were always truest. They were true. And I thought, I know she's right. You get a feeling, and it's as vague as that. I just thought, she's right, I know she is.
So once you started working with her, you know, what really, really impressed you about Cynthia Nixon?
Oh, it's so hard to tell when the performance is so fantastic. You know, she is Emily. But I think it's true of all the others as well. They inhabit their roles completely. Because I said, look, I don't want you to act. I always tell the actors, I don't want you to act. You know, because it's so boring, that. And it's usually just mannerism. B, you have to feel it. Mm-hmm. And that gives you different things. But there are moments when... there are two moments that I run in my mind that still give me absolute joy. One is when she turns around when she's having an argument with Vinny, and she just turns around like this. Just, we can't all have your smug rectitude. And you just see the power in her. And the other is when she gives Reverend Watkins the little book of poems. And the line is, are to be racked by success. That's what the line is. When she said it, I was knocked out. She went, but oh, to be wrecked by success. It just pierces your heart. It's so powerful. And what you do, you just say, all the actors, look, don't act. I trust your emotional judgment. Then you're on really good ground. All you have to do is tweak it.
Amazing. And then the amazing Jennifer, too. I mean, she, you know, and we were talking because she's such a Broadway veteran and Tony Award winner. And what does that bring to you as a director when somebody, and Cynthia too, I mean, her, I'm not, you know, she does Broadway as well, theater, but what does that bring to your vision of somebody when you hire them to do a role? It must add so much because they've got that strong theater background.
It can be a handicap because then you can get theatrical acting. We suffer from a lot of that in Britain, yeah. An awful lot of acting going on, and it's so dull. Yeah. But what is the best of best actors? They care about the emotional landscape in which they're moving, but also the structure and architecture of those roles. And actors do an awful lot of work on their own, and they really, really do a lot. So when they come on and you're orchestrating something, very often you just have to say, no, we'll just do it like this. And sometimes it's pure serendipity. Mm-hmm. When we were doing the scene where Vryling Buffum gets married, we found this wonderful Episcopalian church, and you can't find them anywhere but in America, you can't build them because they're so specific. Now the scene was shot for them inside and to say goodbye to Vryling outside. We couldn't use the outside because it was all modern and we didn't have the money to dress it. So I said, let's just do it inside the church. I said, well, just let's set up the wide shot first. And they were in their place roughly, and the camera was here. And it was on rails, and somebody had forgotten to put the brake on, and it slid down like this. So that's the shot. We don't need anything else. That's serendipity. That's luck.
I was going to say, you're a lucky guy, I have to say. Do you love doing these period pieces? Is it something that you
But I don't see them as period. Okay. I see the past as still being very much alive. Yeah. Oddly enough, it was my best subject of school. History was my best subject. I don't see it as a foreign country. I see it as alive and living because it affects what we are now. It just does. And if you're charting a specific story, that whether it's period or modern, that's not the point. It's the story that's important. I happen to make films that are period. I think it's partially because I feel safe there. I'm a technophobe. I can't use any of this technology. And I'm sort of repelled by the modern world. I don't like its narcissism. And I have a mobile phone. If it goes off and I don't know who it is, I switch it off and I shout at it. No, and that's it.
I love talking to you. This is my best interview of the film festival, hands down. Oh my God, I feel so the same way that you do. Oh my goodness, this is so great. What do you think it is about Emily's poetry that she became so popular, that people, what was it about it that people just loved reading her work? What do you think?
Well, I mean, she's talking, she's experiencing the world, but at a very, very deep level that most people don't experience. Like Audrina says, she has her skin missing, but that makes life very hard because the response to things is deep, particularly in friendships, but the world. How do you cope with the world and death? How do you cope with that? And that's her constant struggle. And sometimes she's stoic, and sometimes she's horrified that it's happened, mm-hmm. and sometimes it's almost wry. Mm-hmm. And when we were doing the guide track for the poems, and it was only meant to be a guide track, because some of the shots were timed to the poems, it was so good. Since the agent said, are you going to redo it? I said, no, it's just so right. I don't want to touch it. Yeah. And because I could not stop for death, which I had heard in a rather solemn way, she says it in sort of, it's wry. It might be happening to someone else, and that's what makes it so powerful. Like all great poetry, it says eternal things, like the sonnets of Shakespeare, like Eliot's Four Quartets and Prufrock. They tell you so much, and it's timeless because they're telling you a central truth. Yeah. How do we experience the world and how we are changed by that experience? For the roses are the look of flowers that are looked at. God, that's fantastic.
Yeah. Oh yeah, her stuff. It's really, yeah, when you really start to rip it apart and oh yeah, it's beautiful. Well, thank you for this absolutely stunning film. And you've done such a, like I say, I just had a wonderful time talking to you. What are you going to bring us for next step? Come on. Are you going to starting to work?
Yes, well, I've got two lined up. Okay. First time, I think I'm in danger of becoming prolific, but I'll get medication.
No.
One is based on a book by Richard McCann called Mother of Sorrows, which is a lovely book. It's a collection of short stories, but it is a lovely, lovely, gentle story, although really very dark. And the other thing I'm writing now is about Siegfried Sassoon, because he was one of the three great poets of the First World War, and he was the only one who survived. I want to get that ready for 2018 for the anniversary of the end of the First World War.
Wow.
And his poetry is wonderful. He also wrote a very witty poetry. I mean, when I got into drama school, you had to do a piece of Shakespeare and a piece of your own choice. And I chose a poem called Concert Interpretation. It was the first performance of the Rite of Spring in England in 1913. And you know, it caused uproar in Paris, but the British were far too polite to be in uproar, so they sort of accepted it. And he just simply tells you about the people in the audience. Yeah. And there's one wonderful verse. And in the gallery, cargo to capacity, no tremors bode eruptions and alarms. They're listening to this not quite new audacity, as though it were by someone dead, like Brahms.
Amazing. You know what? I really think you should star in one of your own films.
Oh, God forbid.
He's amazing. I'm telling you, cast yourself, or I'll direct you. There you go. It's always such a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you so much, and best of luck with this film. It's